Ostrowsky. And actors Matthew Beard. And now it's Lawther. Start with thank you all for coming out tonight. I know you guys have been on a busy circuit, jet setting around at least the United States, if not the globe. So thank you very, very much for coming down here to Orange County.
Thank you for having us.
So I'm a big believer in starting with the beginning. And so to the producers, I'd like to say sort of what is the origin story of your project?
So the origin of this story begins in the fall of 2009 when Nora and I read an article online in which then Prime Minister Gordon Brown apologized for the treatment of Alan Turing during World War II. And I think our first reaction was to the fact that there was such a belated apology for something that had happened so many decades prior. And that was quickly followed by us wondering who Alan Turing was because, you know, shamefully, we had never heard of him before at that moment. So that was the beginning, and we sort of researched his story and found it, you know, obviously so incredibly tragic and disturbing and inspiring and moving and sort of everything, it all in one. And I think we thought perhaps there was a chance, you know, that it could be cinematic or, you know, actually be a film. And I think the next step was optioning the book.
And Ido and I had come from television. We were both assistants, so we knew that having a book meant a lot in the studio space. So we sort of researched what would seem like the definitive biography. We found Hodge's book, and his book was from the 80s, so it wasn't a competitive situation. We did some research, we found out the rights were available. I went to London and met with him and his agent and convinced him that Ido and I, who at the time were in between jobs, were the perfect people to tell the story. And so we came back with this book, and we didn't really know. We knew we had to set it up, but we weren't sure how to do that. We assumed it was a studio film, and we slowly realized we needed a writer. And that's where Graham Moore, our screenwriter, came into play. And I had met him on a staffing meeting when I worked in television and had stayed in touch. And so I was having a party at my house, and I was sort of doing the song and dance you do when you're not working. And I said, don't worry, I optioned this book, don't feel bad for me. And Graham actually overheard me and knew who Alan Turing was and said, you know, one day when I'm a famous screenwriter, I'm going to write that. That's going to be my passion project. So I said, hold on 1 second, and I called Ido, and I said, I think I found someone, but we still made him pitch us, and we worked with him for about a year. We went through 4 drafts, and then finally turned it into his agents to read, but it was a passion project, a side project. Fortunately, Ido and I got other jobs at the time, so we were able to pay the bills, but, you know, it was just a story that we wanted to tell and did all the side.
And I know it had originally gone over to a large studio, and you were able to bring it back. How was it kind of then sort of reinitiating the project?
Well, when we first got it back, I think we were disappointed, obviously, because we thought it was, you know, greenlit and ready to go. And fortunately, the rights to the project reverted back to us, so it didn't die on the vine. And at that point, I think a couple months prior, or actually 6 months prior to us getting it back, it had topped the blacklist the script had, which is sort of a list of, you know, the best unproduced screenplays in Hollywood. So there was still some attention and still some heat on the project overall. And once we got it back, we knew that we wanted to make it independently. We were very fortunate to meet the third producer who couldn't be here tonight, Teddy Schwarzman, who was, you know, very much a creative partner, and his company helped us put the pieces back together and resuscitate it.
And as far as a director, you know, and as a side note to our film festival attendees, the director of tonight's film also did a wonderful Norwegian film called Headhunters, which was at the festival a few years ago.
So we actually watched Headhunters, and we're really impressed with, you know, Morton's directing the technical component, the comedy, the thriller component. And when we sat down with him, he was really passionate about the material. And for us, it was really about, you know, the character study element, but then also really trying to bring in the stakes and the war. And I think he opened up the script even more. For us, it was a really collaborative project, and he was really passionate about it. So he was the first piece of the puzzle right after we partnered with Black Bear and Teddy.
All right, for our actors this evening. Again, you're portraying historical figures, and had you heard of Alan Turing before?
No, ashamedly not. I think that was the, especially I found them over here, people have said like, oh my God, we're so embarrassed, we didn't know this story, but you must have known it, right, because you're English and you must have been taught it at school. Not at all. Like I'd heard of Enigma, and I'd heard Alan Turing, I didn't really know how it all connected, and I certainly didn't know anything about what happened to him after the war. And I think that's a mixture of it being a secret, as it was for many years, but I think also a huge part of that is an embarrassment, feeling completely ashamed with how the government treated him. So why would we teach it? Why would we tell kids how terrible we've been? So, it kind of made sense. And then that was why a huge reason, I know all of us from doing these Q&As and listening to other people's answers, we all were so drawn to it, not just because of the talent behind the camera, but also because we all just wanted to get that story into other people's ears and to have other people go and Google it and look it up and find out more.
And for Alex, not only are you playing historical character, but you're also, your character flips throughout the film. So you've got your take on Alan Turing and you've got Benedict's take. How did you guys work together on that? Were you able to see any of the dailies or any of that? How did that work itself out?
We had a luxury of a long rehearsal period, almost 3 weeks. In which I was able to meet and talk with Benedict and sort of sit down and discuss who we imagine this man to be based on Graham Moore's wonderful script. But there was nothing ever so formulaic as sort of saying, we'll move his hand like this and his other hand like this. It was... There was just sort of a trust that when we got on set, Morten Tillman at the helm, for me at least personally, I could just sort of use my instincts and how I responded to the writing and trust that the rest would fall into place. I didn't watch Bendix dailies because I think we'd made a decision that it wasn't supposed to be an imitation of his performance, but rather trusting that we'd both come to a similar understanding based on the depth and the intelligence of the writing.
Excellent. Again, superb cast. How were you able to get all these great people together to come to this project?
Well, with Benedict, initially we met him when the project was at a studio and he had read the script and really responded to it and tracked us down through his agent, and we met him for brunch and immediately we could tell that he was obsessed with Alan Turing and felt that he was sort of, going for the role and seemed to really grasp the importance of getting this story out there. So he was the first piece of the puzzle, and then, from there, it was pretty straightforward. Here is the next piece of the puzzle, then these guys, and I think across the board, it became sort of a passion project for everybody. Once we really talked about Alan and his team and what they had accomplished, we became very much a united front, so.
And back to the actors, you mentioned a lengthy rehearsal time, which is... That's a special thing to have on a film today. What were some of the other aspects? Were things, I'm pretty certain, not shot chronologically? What was it like for you guys as far as the overall experience of really working with a team of people? Because this wasn't simply a stand-up performance of one person, but really a team of people working together.
Um, There was sort of this lovely feeling for me at least that we came together and we were part of this team in rehearsals, and that was quite energizing in itself. And then we would go off and film the separate time periods separately. Turing's time at school in the 20s was all shot in Sherborne School for Boys, Alan Turing's actual school when he was a teenager. And that was lovely to be able to be in the location that and surrounded by the walls that Alan was too. And there was a lot of very special things like that with this project.
I think it was really clever of Morton to do the rehearsal period, not just to rehearse. So for example, I didn't just come in to rehearse anything I was in. I met Alex during rehearsals, obviously we have no scenes together, but it was clever because in the gaps we'd sit down and have coffee and share little bits of information we collected about Alan Turing. Well, there's so many incredible stories. You know, each of these characters could have their own films. I mean, it's this wonderful thing where this place, this one hut, collected together the genius minds of England under one roof. And obviously what comes with genius is often quirky behaviour, so all sorts of strange anecdotes come out of that, and there's many books on that. But yeah, it meant that we really bonded over Alan Turing, which was good, because when you're on set, we all felt like we were there for one very unified purpose. You know, actors weren't there because of their career or for a fee or something. They were all there because of Alan Turing, and I think that created a very unique atmosphere on set.
Well, I can say that purity of spirit really did shine through on the film, so that is awesome. How long was the shoot?
44 days, and we had about 8 weeks for production.
And as far as the interesting anecdotes about Turing, was there anything that sticks with you as far as some of the stuff that the other cast maybe found out? Or was...
I remember talking to Benedict about how Alan at school, in his school reports, was described as sort of messy, and his buttons were often done up wrong, and he would get ink on his fingers, and was always sort of a bit of a scramble in the classroom, which was something that has stuck in my mind quite endearingly. So this genius mind forming, but also sometimes he forgot how to tie his tie up properly. It's sort of a lovely idea that That's one anecdote I remember.
There's a bit I've noticed in the film, and it's not made a big deal, I don't think, but he chained his mug to the radiator, and you can spot it, I think, if you see his little bit, because he's so OCD about anyone touching his things that he handcuffed it to the radiator so no one could get it, and that's a true bit. But also, I know that they dredged the lake at Bletchley Park, and they found loads of mugs, and they couldn't work out why there would be all these mugs at the bottom of a lake. And then they found a historian who told them that they'd often be circling the lake when they were working on a specific problem. And when they'd have that kind of eureka moment, or when they were working for so long, they'd sort of just throw their mug in the lake because they didn't have time to wash up, and they didn't want to wash up. They're quite messy, sloppy individuals. So they just threw it in the lake. And they dredged it many years later and found all these mugs from code-cracking moments.
And as from the standpoint of, you know, being producers, you know, what has this experience been like for you?
I would say, in a nutshell, overwhelming. We felt different ways at different points in the process, but I'd say at this moment in time, when the movie's, you know, finally out, and we're hearing people say that this is the first time they've heard of Alan's story, and that they're excited that it's finally getting out there, I think we feel tremendously, you know, gratified. And even the sort of tangential things that are happening, where now we have tech titans and LGBT leaders and you know, military leaders commenting about Alan Turing and his contribution to the war effort and to the world. I just think we feel so honored by all of the attention.
Awesome. And with that, I'm going to open it up for a few questions. Yes, Kathy. So let me just quickly paraphrase. I've been looking at, you know, incredible story of his life. How did you choose what to focus on?
It's a very good question. I think the, Graham deserves a lot of credit, as does Morton, as the chief, you know, architects of this film and the story. I think early on we landed on the idea of trying to hit three different time periods and interweaving them, because it is such a daunting task to cover any man's story, but particularly, you know, when you approach a person who's a genius, there's a huge sense of humility that you have to approach the subject matter with. But I think, you know, what Graham and Morton did so beautifully was take these three time periods and interweave them in such a way that I think you do get the critical moments of this man's life. And, you know, you do see at the end the tragic sort of undoing. You know, it almost has like a Greek tragedy feel to it. But, you know, as in any film, you have to compress and get a whole lifespan in 2 hours, so it's a challenge, but I think we're really proud of what Morton and Graham and our cast and crew pulled off with it. I think, you know, as I alluded to earlier, the challenge is always to compress an entire, you know, lifetime of information into one movie. So I think what Graham had to do and what Morton, you know, what they were challenged with was just finding, you know, key critical moments, you know, to toy with. And I think, you know, it's the things that seem the most outlandish, or the areas that you think we took artistic license that are strangely the true things, like the fact that he and Joan were engaged, and, you know, that was a real relationship, or Christopher, you know, being his sort of first true love and the impetus for the project. But I think, you know, some that come to mind, I think Kira's character didn't come to Bletchley through the crossword puzzle, although they did use crossword puzzles to actually, you know, find people to work at Bletchley Park. She came in a more straightforward manner.
And a few of the characters that we put in HUD 8 were all codebreakers, real people that were there at that same time, but we sort of, there was sort of a combination of a few other people, just so that we could get all the information and all the people in one HUD.
Yes, sir.
Are any of Alan's relatives alive still, and did they see the film, and what was their impression?
So the question was, are any of Alan Turing's family still alive, and have they seen the film yet?
A few of them are his nieces, who I think the eldest was 18 when Alan passed away. They were able to meet with Benedict and Morton and sort of help, you know, describe him and help Benedict sort of find the character. And his nephew is the head of the trust now and on the board at Bletchley, so we were able to screen it for, I think it was 36 members of his family, extended family in the UK. The same with Christopher's family as well. And everyone was, you know, we had a really great response, and that was a great relief when they, you know, saw the film and were happy with it.
Had it not been for his arrest, do you feel that perhaps his story would have been disclosed in some other manner? And secondly, for the actors, what kind of projects are you currently working on now?
I guess I'll take the first part. I think because of the Official Secrets Act, no matter what, his story, you know, probably wouldn't have reached critical mass for a long time. But, you know, I do think the arrest, you know, obviously brings a larger sense of outrage to the story and makes it something that we felt even more compelled to share because, you know, that the theme of ignorance or homophobia is still problematic today. We're not past it or over it. So I think it just compelled us to get the story out even more than we would otherwise. And what are you two working on?
At the moment, I'm in London, sort of twiddling my thumbs and auditioning and things. I have a project coming up in later on in the springtime, and a couple of a movie that I made just after Imitation Game coming out in March time, Express Y, which I think is part of this festival.
Yes, we can actually secretly announce to you that we've selected one film for the film festival.
And it happens to be
Alex's next film.
And I just came back from... Sorry?
It's called X Plus Y.
Yeah, and I just came back from France having... I made another film with the lovely Juliet Stevenson, which will hopefully be out sometime later this year or early next year. Your turn, Matthew.
I'm off to Broadway to do a play in a couple of months. So I did it in London last year and it's transferred to Broadway, so it's called Skylight and it'll be one of the Golden Theatre. So I'm very excited to be doing that. It's my first ever play.
And it's brilliant.
I wasn't looking for sympathy, it's just I'm terrified.
So I'm sure you guys are Imitation Game 24/7.
Yes.
That is correct.
Yes. One last question.
It was fairly accurate. Our production designer, Maria Jerkovic, worked with Bletchley, and all those dials worked, all of them are exactly as was. I think the only liberty we took is it actually is in a box, but we moved it out of the box just to make it more visual, and Morton added more, there was red wiring, but we added more red wiring just to sort of give it the life of Christopher and make it feel more like the veins and the, lively, more visual.
Well, a couple of things. You've got numerous Golden Globes, SAG. You just got today the nod from the Producers Guild. We are very proud to be able to bestow to you guys, and we'll be doing a big presentation in London a month from today. So on behalf of the Newport Beach Film Festival, Visit Newport Beach, the City of Newport Beach, and the Orange County Film Society, Best Picture and Best Ensemble Cast. So thank you guys. And again, I want to thank all of you. I want to thank our guests tonight, and especially to all of the Guild, Academy, and BAFTA members who are here. Thank you for coming out. And again, vote, vote, vote. So thank you all very much.